we just saw. So currently we actually saw the chart of Reliance. We also saw the chart of ICICI Bank. No, sorry, ITC. So what we just realized for ourselves was these two stocks. So Reliance, when we see the broader picture after November 2020, so it is looking like in a range bound manner. So talking about ITC, if I see the last couple of weeks, ITC is also looking out in a sideways manner. So it is actually very much important that what duration of time we are looking into. So when we are talking about the trend, it is very important that what duration of time or the period that we are looking into matters. So same stock, if I see Reliance after March 14th, if I am not wrong. So if I am having a look at the chart of Reliance, after March, mid-March, okay, the stock Reliance is looking like in a downside trend in the one-day time frame. The same Reliance stock is actually looking in a range-bound manner when I'm seeing the last couple of months. So just figure out for myself that when the period of time I'm looking into also matters. So it is not just a stock. The same stock could be having different trends when I look into a different time frame. Okay. So we started off by understanding that 30% of the times, that is when markets trend, and the rest 70% of the times markets are supposed to be sideways. Okay. Then we kind of actually got into learning that a typical uptrend is actually one way we see a higher high, higher low formation, and a typical downtrend is one way we see a typical lower low, lower high formation. Now the next thing that we learned is that the same chart or the same stock would be having different trends in different time frames. For example, if I look at something in the one day time frame, the trend might actually be looking up. But when I'm looking into the last day, okay, I'm just, okay, so now I'll do something. I'll just zoom into this last particular day. Okay, so in the one day time frame, maybe this is the candle. Now, if this is the candle formation. Now, if I get into the last day, specifically the last day, I would actually see for myself the last day the stock would be in some sort of a consolidation. So I can say that in the last day, so this would be maybe checked out in the 5 minutes or in the 15 minutes time frame. I see that, yeah, the stock is actually in a sideways manner or in a range bound phase in the last trading day. But in the 1 day time frame, the stock is actually looking on the bullish sentiment, on a higher high, higher low formation, a typical uptrend. Now my question is like, which would be better? So we get analyzing in a shorter time frame, or we have a look at the charts in the larger time frame, which would be better?
Larger.
So obviously, it is better that we start with the larger time frame. So we get started with the larger time frame, and we'll figure out for ourselves how is the trend looking like in the larger time frame. So for example, if I realize for myself a stock is in a bullish phase in the larger time frame, it'll always be better that I check out for long opportunities on the stock. Long opportunities means one where you buy something first and you look forward to sell it off at a higher price. Now in the larger time frame, I see this is in an upside trend. Then what can be done next? Then I'll get into the shorter time frame. Okay. So if I'm doing intraday trading, I could start off on the 1 day time frame. Then I could get down into the 1 hour time frame and then into the 15 minutes time frame and check out for the trend. I could mark the levels also on these particular time frames. Okay. Then I could check out for opportunities based on the levels, all the things that I'm studying in the larger time frame. Then I could check out for a trade in the shorter time frame. That makes sense. So for something that is in an uptrend in a larger time frame, it is best that I check out for positive side opportunities, that is long opportunities for this particular stock. Now for something that is in a bearish trend or in some sort of a bearish sentiment, it is always best that I check out for short opportunities. Now what will happen if I actually start with the 15 minutes time frame? I probably would be seeing that the stock is in a bearish trend. Okay, at times when I'm checking only the 15 minutes time frame, I see that the trend of the stock is in the bearish side. But in the larger time frame, the stock would actually be in the upside sentiment, bullish sentiment. Now if I just have a look at the shorter time frame and I decide to go for a short sell position, then there is a high chance or a high likelihood that my trade will actually go wrong. Why? Because I'm looking forward to trade against the trend. But if I saw that in the larger time frame the stock has been in a bullish phase. If I just show for myself that the stock has been in some sort of a bullish phase in the larger time frame itself, then I'll be more keen. So I started with a larger time frame and analyzing the chart in the larger time frame, then I myself will actually be more keen in checking out for long side opportunities. Right? I've been interested in checking out for long side opportunities because I started from the larger time frame. So I saw that the trend is up. So when I get into the lower time frame, even I see or spot some short opportunities, I won't be much attracted towards it. Why? Because I personally have a perception and I saw on the charts for myself that in the larger time frame the stock is looking bullish. So I'll kind of, as far as possible, I will avoid the short side opportunities. Okay. And this approach where we start from the larger time frame. Okay, I'll just give you a recent example. Okay, so this approach is what we refer to as a top-down analysis. Okay, so for example, let's kind of talk about the COVID cases. So yesterday we kind of actually saw that we had some reporting of around 2 lakh cases in India. Okay, so let's assume we had a reporting of 2 lakh cases in India, and today we see that the number of cases has actually kind of dropped down to 1.5 lakh. Okay.
Yes,
so last 2 days, so this is yesterday and this is today, we saw that the number of reported cases has actually dropped down to 1.5 lakhs. So will you be happy?
Yes,
you'll be happy. Yesterday they reported 2 lakhs.
2 lakhs.
Today they reported only 1.5 lakhs. You'll be happy. But what if I tell you, day before yesterday the number of cases were just 80,000, and from 80,000 the number of cases reported increased to 2 lakh. And then from there it came down to 1.5 lakh. Now you will be like, okay, a bit worried. Because day before yesterday, the number of cases were just 80,000. From there it went up to 2 lakh. Then it came down to 1.5. So this is not something to be happy about. Because the day before that, the number of cases reported per day were around 50K. And the day before that, it was just 40,000. Okay, I'm just giving you a random example. These numbers are not right. Okay. So then it was 30,000. So all of a sudden, we see that there is a huge spike. Okay, so what is the overall trend? Trend is actually high. Like trend is like, yeah, the number of cases are increasing. So that is what we actually realize for ourselves from the trend. The trend is actually indicating in such a manner that the number of cases could actually spike up. So just by having a look at the last 2 days, can I say that this is something that we should be happy about or something that we should be relaxed about? No. But we should be having a look at the bigger picture. So having a look at the bigger picture always gets us a better understanding of the sentiments, a better understanding of the trend of the stock. And that is what we refer to as a top-down analysis. Okay. In simple words, we start by having a look at the bigger picture and then we get down into the shorter time frames. Okay. So we start off by having a look at the bigger picture, that is the larger time frames. Okay. Then we get to a shorter time frame. Then we get to a shorter time frame than that. Then we get forward to execute our trades. Okay. So simple words, top-down analysis sounds simple, but this is very effective. You start from the larger time frame, then you get into the shorter, then you get into the shorter time frame, and then you think about executing a trade. So this will give you a higher chance that you are going to be in the direction of the best trend. Okay. That is. For intraday trading, we would recommend larger time frame. It would be 1 day time frame. Then you get into the 1 hour time frame. Then you get into the 15 minutes time frame. And we personally look forward to execute our trades based on the levels and the trends that we see in the larger time frame. And we execute our trades in the 5 minutes time frame. So we have a look at the candles in the 5 minutes time frame based upon the levels that we observe in the other time frames, and then we go ahead and execute our trades. Okay. Now, the reason for this purpose, the entire methodology, the reason for following the entire methodology is nothing else but the fact that within a trend itself, there could be multiple trends. Okay, within an uptrend itself, there could be a small downtrend. So if I zoom in this and see, so within an uptrend itself, there could be some sideways trend, there could be some downtrend, etc., etc. So if I start from a smaller time frame and I see that, okay, the trend is actually downside, I won't be interested in checking out the larger time frame. So my mind will be like, okay, the trend is down. But the bigger picture trend would actually be really bullish. And you'll think that, okay, the trend is down, and you'll think about shorting opportunity. We want to completely eliminate that mistake. where we are trading against the broader trend. So that is why we say that we should always start with a top-down analysis, where we start analyzing the charts on the larger time frame, and then we get down into the shorter time frame. So this will help us get a better chance of being in the direction of the trend. In the direction of the trend, this is what we refer to as the concept of top-down analysis. So let's have a look at some top-down analysis. Okay. We can get to know the broader trend, and trading with the trend becomes easier once we start doing top-down analysis. Now, let's quickly understand, okay, what can actually be done based on whatever we have learned so far. In any stock or any index, whatever we take, we'll definitely be able to figure out that 70% of the times, as I mentioned, is going to be sideways, and this rest 30% of the times that it would kind of actually stay trending. Okay. So what can be done once this part is realized? So can't we try to define the range within which the market is actually staying? Can we kind of actually try to define the range within which the market is staying? And then couldn't we actually go ahead and check out for trading decisions based upon that? That is, based upon the range that we define, can we check out for trading decisions?
Okay.
Yes. So that is what we are going to learn next, or we are going to trying to learn the concept of support and resistance in simple words. For example, something that is traveling in an upside trend, it's forming a high, it is forming a low, it is forming a high, it is forming a low, it is forming a high. Okay. Or it is forming a high, it is forming a higher high, it is forming a higher low. So what happens? So what kind of actually happens once one high is getting taken out? So what do you actually realize for yourself once one particular high level is actually getting taken out?
Support.
So if this high level is actually getting taken out, I just figure out for myself that yeah, this high is getting taken out, it is forming a fresh high, coming down again, it is moving towards a fresh high. So I can call this to be a level, I can consider this to be as a level, then can't I do that? So can't I kind of consider this high to be a level? Okay, let's forget about the first high, but can't I just consider this to be a significant, just use a different pen. So can't I just consider this to be a significant level then? Or can't I just consider this to be a resistance? I could say, yeah, if the price is managing to pierce further above this particular level, that could actually drive the price further higher. Because this looks like it formed a high, formed a low. Again, it is forming a higher high. It is forming a higher low. So what I could kind of actually convey is, if another high, okay, or if the price is managing to break above this particular higher high, that could actually drive way for a further upside move. A further push could happen from the downside, that is driving the price further on the upside, right? So some momentum could come in, pushing the price up. So I'm assuming, I'm not telling you this is going to happen, but I could say this could actually act as a point of resistance. If the price is capable of managing to pierce above this, a further upside move could happen. And if the trend is continuing, another higher high will form. And then again, a higher low if forms. Again, if this trend is continuing, I'll be able to drive the trend. So you could say that.
Yes.
Right. So same way, so this are some aspects, or this are some logics that we are discussing. But honestly speaking, we can't trade based on this.
Mm-hmm.
But we need to understand these aspects. We can't trade based on this, we need to understand this. Let's move towards the next part. What about a downside market? A low followed by a high, again a low followed by a high. So a low, a high, again a low. This low is lower compared to the previous low. Again a high, but this is a lower high. So this high is actually high. Sorry, this high is actually lower compared to the previous. So I call this a lower high. So this is a typical downtrend. Now, if the price manages to take down this particular low, so what sort of happens if the price is capable of managing to take down this particular low? So if the price is actually capable of managing to pierce this particular low, I could say that could drive way for further downside move or further downside fall, right?
Yes.
Why? Because this is a low that got formed. So this looks like in a sort of a typical downtrend where it is forming a high, a low, a lower low, a lower high. And if this trend or this pattern is actually to repeat, I could say a further low could be formed, or a fresh lower low would actually be formed. and again a high could actually get formed, which is lower compared to the previous high. And if I'm able to ride this trend, the price would move down. That is, if I make an entry for a short, if I go for a short when this lower low is actually getting broken, that could drive way for further downside move. I realize that, right? So these particular points, okay, or these particular points could actually help you, okay, or these lower lows, or simple words, I could say, in the case of an uptrend, these lower lows or these higher high points, in the case of an uptrend, a high, a low, a higher high, a higher low, okay. So these lower low points or these higher high points could actually help you identify possible entry points to catch up with the trend. Okay, so this could actually help you identify some good entry points to catch up with the trend, but you can't trade based on this. As simple as that. It will help you identify possible entry points. That's it. Okay. Now there's a lot of other things that we'll have to look into before we trigger an entry, but definitely this can be used as a reference. Now let's actually move forward and understand concepts a bit more better. Okay. So I was actually mentioning to you that we are going to deal with the concept of support and resistance. To understand this example better, let's take a scenario. Let's talk about a bouncing rubber ball. Okay, so let's kind of actually talk about a bouncing rubber ball. You're dropping the ball on the floor, it hits the floor. From the floor, it is picking up, it is moving up. Again, it falls, again, it picks up, again, it falls, and the process keeps on being repeated. So it is touching the floor, picking up, touching the floor, picking up, touching the floor, picking up. So what do you think is the exact reason why the ball is bouncing up? It is nothing else but because of the fact that the floor over here is exerting an upside force that is actually helping the price to pick up. Or the floor over here is actually putting in some pressure that is pushing the price further upside. Right? What if this floor wasn't there? So what if this floor wasn't there? Then what would happen? Okay, let's say the floor was only there till here. Price will actually face some sort of a support over here. It will get pushed up over here. It will get pushed up over here. But when it kind of approaches this particular level, it would face rejection. Oh, sorry, it would kind of actually fall down further. So there is no floor over here to support the ball. And what actually happens if the ball gets, ball falls down? Okay, it doesn't face any sort of a support over here. Rather, it drops down just like that. Why? Because there is nothing to support the price over here. And it makes a free fall, I could say.
Free fall, okay. Sir.
Okay. Now let's talk about a scenario. Let's get back to the same example. Okay. So the bouncing ball.